Hey, shalom, greetings. I'm Alonso, Alonkone Teferi, and let us continue. So now we're still on the Book of Jobs, but now we're gonna focus and our attention to the section in Scripture which is recognized and known as the poetic books, and it's not just poetry, you know. Poetic and prophetic is kind of, it's similar, right? But indeed it is. There's a substantial amount of prophecy within the poetic books. And you know, just an example, a few are is on the Psalm of David, Proverbs, Book of Job, Lamentations, you know, and a few others that are considered the poetic books. Now let us consider that that this poetic form, this form of poetry, which is classified as rhythm, is okay. Don't make the mistake of assuming or pretending that rhythm is only limited to rhyming. So it's not really the sense of rhyming. Rhythm goes beyond that. You know, there's more to it. And in this case, it could be described and it could be understood as repetition of ideas, classified as parallelism, or you know, known as repetition of ideas in a parallel form, you know. And so that's the whole, you know, that's the background behind these poetic books that contain. There's three different kinds of parallelism, or repetition of ideas that could be implemented within one's writing, a poem or song, whether it be a poem or a song, or you know. And so let me just take note that let me just make mention rather that already there's the connection with Deuteronomy, the study on the Book of Deuteronomy, being that deus is two, and oromos, it's word or law, but it's the idea of you know, the second time around. And so we you know, surely enough, that repetition is also being expressed in the Book of Job in either of the three forms, right? But and so you could see how it relates. But let's get into the description of these three different forms, which are gonna go hand in hand, are basically gonna complement what we had previously dealt on or covered, being the metaphysical plan of salvation, you know, the salvation plan, the three steps in the Book of Job, and as well as I'm not sure if we covered from Babylon to Timbuktu, but the three phase, I believe we did. But so it'll go hand in hand with that. And so, you know, let's get right into it. So the first form of parallelism, or in the sense of repetition of ideas, the first form is recognized excuse me, as synonymous. So synonymous would be the label, the term that would represent the example I'm about to express. So an example of, and this is good for musicians and all people in general, but it's really interesting. So the first type is of parallelism is synonymous, and it deals with having a thought to repeating a thought like identical, like exactly how one verse and then the verse to come exactly in exactitude it's a repetition in all its entirety of the verse prior to it. So, you know, I'm just using all kinds of words that just confuse me. So I'm just gonna jump right into the example. So a good example would be a good example of parallelism in the synonymous form would be, the Lord will be refuge for the oppressed, a refuge in times of trouble. So it's basically like it goes hand in hand. It's basically identical. No growth, no difference, just plain repetition. And so second form of parallelism, writing, poetry, however, whatever the work that one is doing, the second form would be antithetic. I'm not sure if I pronounced that right. Antithetic would be antithetic or something, you know, I can't really pronounce that, forgive that, but it would be when ideas contrast. So it would be like kind of like one verse says something and then the verse that follows is the complete opposite. An example of that would be, the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. You know, completely opposites, but still it's a repetition of idea. The only difference is that they are of, you know, they differ in poles. You know, they're completely opposite to each other, but maintaining the same root of that which is trying to be expressed. In this case, would be behavior, or you know, good and bad. So continuing, the third form of parallelism, repetition of idea in the poetic form sense would be synthetic. I'm not sure if I misspelled it, synthetic maybe, or synthetic, I don't know, but nonetheless it's when a thought is developed or enriched by the parallel. So and these three different forms of repetition just make poems or writings to be epic, lyrical, dramatic, you know. And so back to synthetic or synthetic. When a thought is developed or enriched, when there's growth, there's perfection. And so an example of that would be, yeah, it's synthetic, I believe. So, thou shalt be secure because of hope. Yea, thou shalt dig about thee and shall take the rest in safety. So that would be an example of synthetic parallelism. And further expound on it, it's so the premise is, thou shalt be secure because of hope. But then in the second verse, it goes on to further explain and give detail of how it is that hope will come about. So it grows and develops the idea presented in the premise in the previous verse. Yea, thou shalt dig about thee. So now it's describing a digging process, and shall take thy rest in safety. So it's building. And the reason this is significant is because, if you haven't already noticed, it goes hand in hand with the three steps for a revolution, and which are just step one, words; step two, fanaticism; and step three, practicality, putting in practice; and doing, motion, acting. And it goes hand in hand with the metaphysical description of Job's situation, the three-step outline for redemption. And same thing, you know, you begin with the word. And keep note, this is important, because if you can point this out in your own life, then you can jump a step, because you know that you're in a lower step, and that now you can avoid it because you're knowledgeable on it. So for example, the first one was, the Lord is the refuge, yes, he shall refuge the oppressed, or something like that. So it's basically the same thing. And so in the sense that it could be applied, is that if, you know, you're kind of supporting, not in this case, but if you happen to comment something negative and then you back it up with more negativity, and even worse, I think, is double, like, it's like doubling up on negativity. So in that sense, you know, like, one could avoid it, so it's not the way to go, you know, in reality. And then the second step would be fanaticism, when you get all hardcore about it, because now you're kind of getting deep into it. So somebody says something and you completely bust out with you completely respond with the complete opposite, you know, because you're all heart at that point, you're all fanatic about it, and people at this point do not like you and do not want to be near you, to be honest. So and it's expressed by the contrast, by the complete polar opposites of repetition. So once that step is over and done with, now you enter into the new, into the growth, the real Christ of mind, the forgiveness, the where you expound on something, you present an idea, and then you grow and you mature with it, you learn. And so that's expressed in the third sense, the synthetic form of parallelism. And you know, this process is in fact establishing humility. You know, a lot of the patriarchs, you know, they were righteous, but they lacked humility, you know. So in a sense, Job, every time something happens, he opens his mouth, just with all due respect, just, you know, just shut up. It's a lesson we all got to learn. We all got to be humble. Don't say anything. Don't respond. Stay quiet. You know, keep your peace. Keep the peace of Jesus. Rest. You know, Selah. Take a pause. Let Jah speak, you know, in I and I behalf. You know, when I and I was younger, in school, I used to go from you know, 10 minutes after school to like to being suspended, because every time they informed me that I was, you know, they would start with letting me know that I was going to stay 10 minutes after class for bad behavior. I would keep adding to it, you know, I would keep responding why and this and that, you know, and eventually it would get to the point where, like, it's either the teacher had to stay there for hours after school, or it was like some other kind of punishment. So it's the same deal, you know, we got to be humble. It's like, that's why I just start asking all those questions, like, who stretcheth the, like, you know, the firmaments of the heavens from one end to the other? It's not you. So keep your, you know, keep your peace, you know, like, don't be all, you know, don't be acting all tough, you know, because you're nothing. And so basically it goes hand in hand with the Torah portion for Rastafari's sabbatical study number 45, because I besought, I humbled myself, I begged, I desired. And so, you know, that direct connection. Now, interesting that the book of Job is broken up in seven parts, and then it's got a prologue, and then it's got, you know, it's like a movie, but like a screenplay. But as for I and I, this motion picture, I and I is to glory in the Bible, and specifically in the commandments of our father, of our brother, even. So yeah, humble thyself, and then well, we went over the nature and nurture, yeah, the psychological debate, it's equal, you know. Job in this case did not have the law, or else there would have been some kind of reference to it, but nonetheless, you know, Moses calls upon heaven and earth to be witnesses, and, you know, scripture coming from heaven, handed over from Yahweh Elohim, and so to Moses, Musa, and, you know, the naturality of things, the nature. You know, Jah mentioned how him put the commandments in our heart, and so, which another direct reference to the Rastafari Sabbath study 45. And you know, it all throughout, you know, you could see Jesus Christus act this out in the New Testament, you know. He even goes to mention on that don't worry about what you're going to say in that moment of persecution, but the Spirit shall speak for a testimony against Jah. Don't incriminate yourself. In other words, you know, keep, you know, that's very important. And you'll notice that whenever this time comes, whoever it is that's gonna, that is asked to testify against Jah Rastafari, you know, Yahweh Elohim, the creator that is good, it always turns out to the Spirit of Adonai, you know, taking the lead, you know, and testifying, you know, to prevent Ayin Dai from, you know, from obvious consequences. And you know, okay, I'm not gonna get ahead of myself, so continuing with that same topic, you know, Pontius Pilate, he says, you know, thou answerest me not, you know, like he Jesus didn't answer, and Pontius Pilate marveled, you know, he kept his peace, you know. It's kind of like don't judge the world, you know, but let the world be judged by the word of truth. So, you know, keep your peace, humble it thyself, take it, and all shall be well, you know, Jah willing. So, oh, and that's a sense of self-righteousness. So now we get to go to scripture. So now we get to see what Brother Paul says in Epistle to the Philippians. It's interesting because Philip and Philippians, not that there's any not that I've made any connection, but it just sounding it out, you know, Philip and Philippians. But it's chapter 3, verses 4 to 9. Let us open up Ayin Dai scripture. I'm trying to go kind of fast because that last video lasted a whole lot more than I would have wanted, and I understand I'm not the you know, the most entertaining of characters, so, but I do present good information, and I would like for all to be able to, you know, to benefit from it. So I'll try to go faster, try to, you know, squeeze in as much as possible in the, you know, in whatever amount of time one's invest on these videos. And now that I bought myself enough time to find the scripture, I can continue. So it's Philippians chapter 3, verses 4. I begin at verse 4. So, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man think it that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. That kind of even confused that, right? But that's not the focus of the matter. Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee. Concerning zeal. Oh, so this is kind of like Jonah, you know, like, this is kind of like, you know, what is thine occupation? Whence comest thou? You know, I'm pretty sure this is the same thing, except I didn't even realize that until now. So let us just continue by reading. So verse 6 of chapter 3, the epistle of Paul, the apostle to the Philippians. So concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. Take note of touching. So continuing, verse 7. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. What profit Ayin Dai to gain the world, but lose it, Ayin Dai self, you know? Verse 8. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, like worthless, you know, excrement, that I may win Christ. Yeah, so basically a little summary of that is, you know, him that loseth his life for my sake, says Jesus, the same shall save it, but him who saveth it, same shall lose it. Now, you know, give it all up. Give up the pride. You know, it benefit Ayin Dai nothing. there are greater reward in Jesus Christos, you know. So just that pertains to selfishness, self-righteousness. Now, affliction, don't even question Jaja why he's afflicting Aina. It's kind of like a it's a compliment. He cares for Aina, so he's purifying, and through punishment he's perfecting Aina. So don't get offended, rather separate thyself from all physicality, all materialistic illusions, and know that he shall reward us like double, you know, if Aina are to overcome. Now let Aina go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6 verses 31 and 32. I forgot what it's even about, but so it's gonna be a surprise. Let's see what we got. Chapter 6 verse 31-32. So let's see what does this pertain to. Now, okay, it's obviously not chapter 6 because there's no verse 31. Forgive I, but these Roman numerals, you know Romans gotta make things all complicated, you know. So it's actually it's chapter 11 verse 30 or 31. Let I find it first. Okay, yeah, chapter 11, 1 Corinthians. Let's start from verse 30. For if by grace be a partaker, why am I evil spoken of for that? Let I begin again. That was horrible. Okay, For if I by grace be a partaker, why am I evil spoken of for that for which I give thanks? Whether therefore ye eat or drink of whatever ye do, do all to the glory of Jah, Rastafari. Give none offense, neither to the Jews nor to the Gentiles, nor to the church of God, even as I please all men in all things, not seeking mine own profit, but the profit of many, that they may be saved. This is like the Christ consciousness, you know, like the real Christ reality. He's forgiving and loving, you know, true loving. How can one incriminate others, you know, when I and I have had our own personal shortcomings? So, you know, got to mature in that sense. So let's go to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 12. This is going good. Good time, you know. So I would say Hebrews chapter 12 verse, we're gonna start out with verse 7 11. You know, that's the last chapter and verse on Rastafari Sabbatical Study number 45 in the book of Deuteronomy. So continuing, well, let us begin rather from verse 6. That cancels out what I had just previously said, but makes no difference. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If ye endure chastening, God, Jah, Yahweh, deal it with you as with sons. Oh, see, it's a compliment. It's like he's taking the liberty of schooling you. That means you're a son now. That's good news, I would say. That's mighty good news, you know. For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. I did not do justice to that, so continuing. But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. You know, just like everyone else, you know, living the life, you know, the vida loca, you know, here in the States. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? You know, Ras Teferi, the head to revere, to reverence. We put up with fleshy fathers, you know. How much more shall we put up to the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure. See, you know, fleshy fathers at times even do it, you know, for fun. But he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. So he's kind of directing us, kind of trying to get us lined up for holiness. So on the contrary, this is for our good, our sakes. So continuing now, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness to them which are exercised thereby. So yeah, you know, well said, Paul. Yeah, I guess I was left blank. But anyways, nonetheless, you know, nevertheless, just Paul being Paul, giving a good description of how I and I is to be persecuted. Be, you know, it's our job, you know, it's our job, it's what we got to put up with to be workmen, and let us not be ashamed. So the book of Job, it's interesting to note that there's a lot of asking questions, and the most questions are being asked by the Almighty Creator that is good, Yahweh Elohim. And you know, we went over how, you know, scripture and nature provides answers, and no need to sacrifice moral ethics. So okay, let's continue with self-righteousness and lack of humility. Moses, in the case where Aaron and Miriam, where they say, "Hath Jah not spoken by us too?" You know, being like that. So that was chapter. Okay, it's the book of Numbers. Okay, it's chapter 12, same chapter. And Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman which he had married. Fast forwarding to the point. And they said, "Hath the Lord indeed spoken only by Moses? Hath he not spoken also by us?" And the Lord heard it. Now, the man Moses was very meek above all men which were upon the face of the earth. And the Lord spake suddenly to Moses and to Aaron and to Miriam, "Come out, ye three, to the tabernacle of the congregation." And they three came out. And the Lord came down in the pillar of cloud and stood in the door of the tabernacle, and called Aaron and Miriam, and they both came forth. And he said, "Hear now, Shema," you know, "Shema, you two, you deuce, you couple, listen to what I and I have to say." Okay, "Hear my words." This is actually kind of like the introduction to Deuteronomy. "Hear my words. Hear now my words." Okay, continuing. "If there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known to him in a vision, and will speak to him in a dream. My servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all mine house. With him will I speak mouth to mouth, even apparently, and not in dark speeches. And the similitude of the Lord shall he behold. Wherefore then were ye not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? And the anger of the Lord kindleth against them, and he departed." You see, it just, you know, I just understood something. So this again is reference to, you know, Moses speak face to face, mouth to mouth. But very important to note is that dark speeches is kind of like parables. But Yahweh just mentioned that to Moses, he's not even going to speak in parables. That's interesting to note because I was going to mention that every time the spirit of the Lord Adonai come upon anyone that is to testify against Yahweh, that you can tell because right off the bat the spirit starts asking questions and that are complex, and well, to us at least, and speaks in parables. And so that's kind of one clue to how you can tell when it's the spirit of Adonai, speaking on behalf. And so, and we'll get into that right now, as a matter of fact, sooner than later. So just keep in mind that the Book of Life is the Book of Life and it's not the Book of the Dead. And historians that are seeking the dead will not find the living. And that's later on because it deals with the New Testament Torah portion readings of Rastafari Sabbath Study 45, which will be the Gospel of Mateus and Marcos. Now, okay. People are looking for answers in the wrong place, but the book is living, so look for everything in the now, being played out actively. Let's be actively Christians, not just historical. And that's just a little side note, but more okay, we might go to Balaam, but let me just review something really quick. Okay, chapter 18 of John, verse 37. Let's go over that really quick. So that's when it's Pontius Pilate, and Pilate therefore said to him, "Art thou a king, a king then?" Jesus answered, "Thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born. This is why I was lifted." Jesus is saying, "And for this cause came I to the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice." Yeah, and so, just to reference that, but so Jesus came to testify to the truth, and so is I and I, because I and I heareth that voice. So I guess now would be a good time to go to Book of Numbers, the Balaam situation. Okay, we might have to go. This might be a little longer than expected, but okay, let's go over Balaam and call it a session. And I'm not even sure what chapter, but give I just 1 second to figure this out. Now, let me just mention that the holiness. I came across most of this information. I'm trying to learn more about Yisachor or Yisachar. And let me just mention that. I start. I was gonna work, and I'm going to work on Jah willing. On a chart where the signs, instead of having the zoo signs or whatever those worshiping stars people do, the zoology or zodiac. I thought to myself, because it could be arranged properly and correctly with the tribes of Israel, and but I thought Ayanda is not supposed to like accept a sign to define our lives, for we have free will. But then it just came to me that that Jah is a god of holiness, of completeness, and anything that's lacking, he fill it up. So Ayanda is, you know, we're kind of off track in the sense of truth. Honestly, now this is kind of more serious than even before. At least I'm coming to understand. We got to let go of the flesh, because if we say that we are, like, for instance, we're the tribe of Benjamin, and that's it. You're kind of worshiping Benjamin and that character. And Jah, you know, kind of like if you were born in a certain month and that month happens to represent Benjamin, then everything that Benjamin says or the life that Benjamin, the life that plays out in the character or in the simile of Benjamin, then that's going to dictate your life. That doesn't make sense. So, you know, taking the all in consideration, I personally think, it's an opinion at this point, but it's a good one. I think I know that we're to be what we need to be, you know, be yourself, you know, be that which you gotta be. Sometimes you gotta be Issachar, sometimes you gotta work, you know. Sometimes you gotta be the lion of the tribe of Judah and who shall arouse you. Sometimes you gotta be like, you know, you gotta be like the twins, you know, like Simon and Reuben. Sometimes you gotta be, you know, so there's a time and a place, but we're to be holy. We're to be that which I need to be to overcome. You know, so let's not limit ourselves. Let's not put borders to ourselves. The only border is blue, and that's the sky. So let's not transgress the law and but sky's the limit, you know? And the sky, you know, Jah has informed us that it's forever expanding, as is life everlasting. So no limits, basically. Outside of course, what is the law, you know, the commandments of Ayandai Father. Now, I forgot to mention that the whole salvation, the examples, the metaphysical example, the Babylon to Timbuktu example, the forms of poetry in a repetitive or parallelism, it's just to show how scripture can solve I and I problems if we look for it, and it teaches us how to deal with what we're being confronted with. And so I just found all the scriptures to back up and reference the humility. But we'll leave that for the next part to this. But it's very important. Let me just mention. Okay, no, I'm not gonna mention. I gotta go to. Let's go to Balaam. Let's go to Book of Numbers. You know, I can't be doing this. You know, I gotta stick with the program. You know, so let us go to. You know, I keep doing this. I keep losing focus and. Let's see if I wrote down what. I don't need to even check. It's like chapter 22 or something. I'm all trying to. Seem all like if I really knew my stuff, right? But not really, you know. See, it's You know, Ayanda is to be humble because Humpty Dumpty, you know, he fell off the wall. I said chapter 22 and I was completely wrong. It's in fact chapter 24. And when Balaam saw that it pleased the Lord to bless Israel, he went not, as at other times, to seek for enchantments. He set his face towards the wilderness. Keep in mind that this is Jesus Christos and the 40 days of temptation has to do with this. And the wilderness, and then actually, that being said, I can actually I can throw in this scripture here, or this evidence for the 120 days, you know, and we'll go into the visibility and the invisibility of the Almighty Creator, which is the all, the completeness, the whole. But you know, three stages of revolution. You know, a revolution is 360. One, that equals to 1 year, not counting the, well, technically it's not, but okay, so let's stick to the cipher, right? But if you can recall in okay, I don't have the actual reference right now, but if you could recall New Testament, when Jesus Christus is to be crucified, Pontius Pilate mentions that because of necessity, one is to be released. Correct? One is to be released to the public. And so they release. It's all making sense. Okay, forgive I, but it's all making sense now. So one is released, and it's Barnabas, right? The criminal, and you still have three. So that's it would have been four, but now it's one. Now it's the fourth, the tenth part, the 27.7, was given to the Lord. Was let go, and that all has to do with the 10%, because 10% in fact is 27%, as explained in other videos, because you know, the doubling, and I think it has to do with 12 hours in a day, and now we do 24 hours in a day, and the shortening of days. But do the math, you know, you could do it with your paycheck, double it up, and then divide it by 10, and you're gonna eventually come up with 27.7, and you know, the U.S. government deducts 2.7% of your paycheck, but that in fact is not true, because if you do the math, you're going to realize that they double up the decimal, and it's like, instead of 2.7 per hundred, it's like 2.2 seventh hundredths, or I forgot the exact explanation, but it's like they move a decimal, let's see, 27.7. They move the decimal one space to the right. What do you know? And so it turns out being 27%, and so it comes down to 1/4 of your paycheck. And I know this has to do, because I'm sure, but I haven't found the evidence. I haven't even looked, to be honest. But I'm sure that every monetary system is based on a job principle that I have not yet received, and that is why the peso is sometimes valued at this. The you know, the euro is valued at that. There's something there's something biblical that the world is referencing value towards, because it doesn't make sense that you're supposed to be deducted 22.7%, but it turns out to be 1/4 of your paycheck, 27%. It's not just a scam. You see, the devil work it under rules too. It's just that you know, the snake, the serpent knows how to twist and You know, he's wicked like that. He can twist things to his advantage, you know, taking advantage of I and I ignorance. So there's something behind this. There's something more to this. But going back to so Pontius Pilate releases one of necessity, so you're left with three. And one of those three is Jesus Christos, one third is out of the cipher, out of the circle is 120 degrees, and I know that each one of those degrees is a day, and so it could either be 120 days, or 120 years. Or even 1,000 years is like a day to the Lord, to Adonai, so it'd be like 1,200 years, regardless. It's like the 12 tribes, and it all plays in effect, and consider that that which has been released would add up to the 5.7, or no, it's I don't know the exact math, but it would end up being the 7.7 or 7.3, I believe. And so it ends up equaling to 13. It equals to the 27.3 is in fact it's dividing 360, the 360 degrees, or the 360 days of the year, by 13, giving it 13 months in a year. Then you get that same number, you get the 10%, you get the I've kind of said things that are going to confuse the matter, but so let I repeat that. If you divide 360 by 13, you get 27.3 or something close to that. But once again, it equals to the 10%, to because one has been taken away of necessity. So there used to be four, now there's only three. One third of that is 120. And it's kind of like 10%, because remember, the year is 365 days, but five extra days or something, it's the leftover, it's the remainder. It's that goeth to Jah. So I'm just throwing out ideas out there, because this is all related. And indeed it is. And I had forgotten that I was working on something related to this, but might as well. I haven't gotten deep into it, but it's coming together. And there's so many different ways that this plays into effect, and except I gotta find the exact representation of these numbers, of these signs. So yeah, 360 divided by 13 equals 27.692307. And I kind of did I just messed around with numbers. So I divided 360 by 32. Well, first I divided 360 by 33, being that it is, 33 degrees, and it said that Jesus Christ was 33, and the answer to that was 11,880. That was interesting, because you add 120 and you get 1,200. You get 12,000. And that is interesting enough. So then I proceeded to divide 360 by 32, and the answer was 11,520. It didn't get me much closer, but I was trying to see what kind of pattern, see, it's all patterns, and so, but anyways, it's like I'm sure I'm misplacing the decimal somewhere, and for that scripture is to be noted. But anyways, 1520. In this case, 11,520. But if I'm off by a decimal, it could very well be the year 1502. And and even the 11,880 could be representative of 1880, and I could have been off, you know. So you know, just it makes sense to go forward with this. And so just continuing, the reason I went to that is because at first I said, okay, so you know, Jesus Christos was in the wilderness 40 days, 40 nights, and in Old Testament it's 40 years, and the shortening of time, I didn't really get into that, but I did consider it, but for the sake of sticking to the Deuteronomy Torah portion, which I have now abandoned, forgive I, but let's proceed. I had multiplied 360 days or 360 degrees of revolution by 40. Even that makes sense because there was four and one's taken away. So, and it'll give 120, but anyways, 360 times 40 equals 14,400. Now, I know that 14,400, it's one decimal short of the number 144,000, if I'm correct, or at least it's similar, but you get the idea of what's going on, you know, like the kind of mathematics that I can go about. And so I have more work, but it seems not to be here. But, you know, just ideas and, you know, divide 100,044 by 12, and then you get, you know, work with numbers. So I already went off track completely. Let us just really quickly continue with Balaam. So he lifted up his eyes and he saw Israel abiding in his tents according to their tribes, and the Spirit of God came upon him, and he, so see, it's pretty clear, he saw the 144,000 individuals, he saw the tents of Israel, right, abiding. And if you go to Genesis chapter 17 verse 3, or why do I open the off? As for me, it's actually verse 4, chapter 17 of the book of Genesis. As for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. That's pretty clear that Israel is many nations. Okay, might as well go to it. Give I just 1 second, please. You know, we were on a roll, and I completely sacrificed all that to deal with numbers. But there's a prophecy in the book of John that it has to do with oh boy. Okay, give I just 1 second, forgive I for the delay. Yeah, I may not find it. We'll leave that for okay, here we go. It's the Gospel of John, chapter 11, verses, let's start with verse 50. Nor consider that it is expedient for us that one man should die for the people, and that the whole nation perish not. And this spake he, not of himself, but being high priest that year. This is speaking of Caiaphas, something. And this spake he not of himself, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus should die for that nation, and not for that nation only, but that also he should gather together in one the children of God that were scattered abroad. Now, perfect timing, because Balaam is going to get into that same point, which is proof positive of the many diversity, the great diversity amongst the great simplicity being one. Now, and he took up his parable and said, Balaam, the son of Beor, hath said, and the man whose eyes are opened hath said. You see, so this is now the spirit of the Lord, because he picked up his, this is a dark speech. Who can receive this? You know, who can understand? And it's indicative of the presence of Adonai, the spirit, in Balaam. And now continuing, he hath said, which heard the words of God? Which saw the vision of the Almighty falling into a trance, but having his eyes open? How goodly are thy tents? How goodly they keep the commandments would be a good interpretation. O Jacob, and thy tabernacles of Israel. You see, so, leader of many nations. As the valleys are they spread forth, as the valleys are they spread forth, as the gardens by the river's side, as the trees of lined aloes, which the Lord hath planted, and the cedar trees beside the waters. You know, Ein Dai is to be like trees planted alongside the rivers of water, you know. The rivers obey the commandment of Jah. The seasons come when Jah command it. All nature follows Jah commandment except for Ein Dai. So, but we can fix that. He shall pour the water out of his buckets, and his seed shall be in many waters. You see, so Jah be spreading the seed. You know, that man with the carrying or bearing the water pitcher, and his king shall be higher than Agag, and this kingdom shall be exalted. God brought him forth out of Egypt. He hath at his word his strength of a unicorn, the leader, the horn of Africa, even Ethiopia. He shall eat up the nations, his enemies, and shall break their bones and pierce them through with arrows. You know, he couched his majesty. It is good that you are here to take this picture of me of it in my palace garden at Addis Ababa. He's sitting in that couch, in that kuchin, in that tzion, in that resting place. And so he lay down as a lion, and as a great lion, who shall stir him up? Blessed is he that blesseth thee. Blessed be he that cometh in the name of the Lord. That's not included, but it's significant. And cursed is he that curseth thee. And Balak's anger was kindled against Balaam, and he smote his hands. You could even go to the psalm where it says, clap your hands, you know. And Balak said to Balaam, I call thee to curse mine enemies, and behold, thou altogether hast blessed them. Three times. This is kind of like repetition to the fact that he smote the ass three times. That is significant. I ain't gonna go to that. Therefore, now flee thou thy place. I thought to promote thee with great honor, but lo, the Lord hath kept thee back from honor. Recall the New Testament when the devil offered like all the nations and stuff like that. And what does Jesus Christ say? Like, get thee behind thy Satan. You know, I and I shall not transgress the commandments of Jah Rastafari. And it's the same thing going on. It's like Balak is like he's practically saying, man, Jesus, I was going to give you all this gold and silver. But so it's the same scenario and the same event at they're in the wilderness, and they're camped next to Baal Peor. In Spanish, Peor is the worst, you know, Peor. So that's cool. That's funny in a certain way. And continuing. Didn't I tell your messengers? You know, I can't go beyond the commandments. That's exactly what Jesus Christ said, you know. I can't go beyond that. No matter you give me everything in your house, I can't go beyond the law. And now behold, the people come down for So now he's going to prophesy what's going to happen in the latter days. And he took up his parable. So here's the spirit of Yehoshua once more. And said, Balaam, the son of Beor, hath said, and the man whose eyes are opened hath said, which heard the words of Jah, and knew the knowledge of the Most High, which saw the vision of the Almighty, falling into a trance, but having his eyes open. I shall see him, but not now. I shall behold him, but not nigh. There shall come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel, a branch, and shall smite the corners of Moab. Ain is strategically positioned, spread out. The seed has been spread into all the corners of the earth to torment the wicked by speaking truth. That be true. Now, continuing, following the transit. Point. So just one last little note. He takes up his parable again and said, alas, who shall live when God doeth this? And ships shall come from the coast of Chittim, and shall afflict Asher, and shall afflict Eber, and also shall perish forever. And Balaam rose up and returned to his place, and Balak went his way. You know, so just referencing that, and I don't know if I'm gonna stop right there, but the donkey or the ass is significant because it's relative to the mercy seat. So, you know, shalom, give thanks. If I don't even know how much time this was, but I give thanks, and stay tuned for the next part section. Rastafari, guide and protect all and die.